Hi. Yeah, it works. Okay, great. I'm Robert. I'm going to talk a little bit about how and why Erlang evolved and why we think it's still actually very useful or very fits in very well today with the type of applications people are running on it. So it's going to be a little bit of history, not much, I guarantee, a little bit of philosophy, and the way things are done, how it works today. I think we'll probably skip the internals bit. I think otherwise I'll take an hour instead of 35 minutes, and a bit about a pat on the back and show how good we are. So yeah, okay, so I'm Robert Virding. I come from Erlang Solutions. I was originally a theoretical physicist, but then I discovered programming, and after a while I left and started working for Ericsson. And then I ended up in the Ericsson Computer Science Lab. And one of the things we were looking at, well, we were seriously looking at new technology we thought would be interesting for Ericsson. And interesting in this case was to solve the problem. The problem was telecoms, programming telecoms applications. And for example, they had a big switch called AXE, it's still in use, and it's a very successful switch, but it was quite difficult to maintain and develop. So we're looking at how could we improve that. But you still have a specific set of characteristics you have to follow. If you can't follow these system that can handle these things, it's just not interesting no matter how wonderful it is, right? So you have things like actions have to be performed at a certain time and not take more than a certain time. You have a time things. You need distribution. If you want to make a fault tolerance system, you need at least two computers. So you need a concept of distribution for handling that in. It's used to control hardware. That's actually not so strange as it sounds. It's quite large, at least for those days, quite large software systems. They're quite complex functionality. And an interesting one is the system should be able to run for years in continuous operation. It should not crash. And maintenance should be able to be performed on the machine while the machine is actually running, which is also quite interesting. Quality and reliability, yes. It should be fault tolerant. Again, this gets back to the thing about the continuous operation. So when things go wrong, the system should keep on going. And large numbers of concurrent activities. We were thinking telephone exchanges where you might have hundreds of thousands of subscribers, you might have tens of thousands of calls going on at the same time in the system. So this thing when C10K came along, that was something we'd been thinking about for about 10 or 15 years already before that. So from our point of view, it was just not a non-issue. Right? C1 million K, that's getting interesting. But C10K is... Okay, so we did a lot of work in the lab, and we had our own small switch, which is the thing at the back there. That's actually a small PABX with four telephones in it, connected to it. And we connected that to our machine so we could control that from the systems we were running. That's me at work.
With train?
Pardon?
With small train?
With small trains. What we were doing, we were going, I think it was a trade show we were going to show Erlang. And showing them a telephone exchange, even something like that, is totally uninteresting. There are no blinking lights, no nothing, right? So how are we going to demonstrate Erlang and try and attract people? We'll have a train set. So we had a train set running, which was controlled by Erlang. We went slightly overboard. So I developed an ATC train control system for it, so you could go in, you could. It would know the setup. You could say, oh, I want to move a train from here to here and have multiple trains running and they would never collide and things like this. Another colleague did a graphics interface so you could see the board on the screen and where the trains were. Another one did, we didn't know it then, but it was a DSL for describing how to control the trains. But it was all written in Erlang and it was fault tolerant. If something went wrong, it just stopped all the trains. So you never got train crashes. But so it was work, but I'll admit it was fun. Anyway, so we were developing Erlang for this. And some reflections we had while we were on what we were working with then is we were not trying to implement a functional language, okay? This was not a goal. Actually, we didn't have a goal of implementing a language at all, okay? We were not trying to implement the ACTA model. Okay. We did not know about the ACTA model. Someone came along afterwards and told us, you're implementing the ACTA model. And we said, oh, are we? Then you go up and read the papers and find, yes, we're implementing the ACTA model. We were trying to solve the problem. How do you design a system, a language and or system, for programming these types of applications? This was our goal. It just so happened we found there was no language we thought was suitable, so you end up doing your own language, for example. We arrived at the ACTA, what was the ACTA model, or what became the ACTA model, because we felt this was the right way of building these systems. This gave the right set of features we wanted. That's why we arrived at it. Let's see what I've written here. Okay, this had the property, it made the development of the language and the system very focused. Because we could say, is this useful for what these type of applications, yes or no? Yes, we would keep it. No, we would get rid of it. I'll point out, we were not just implementing a language. We were also thinking about at the same time, how can we use this language? Why have we got this language? How can we use it for building these type of systems? So the features that went into the language, they went in there because we could use them to build these type of systems. So it's not just cool features, it's cool features that solve a problem we actually had. And it also gave us a set of criteria. We came up with a great new idea. Did it help us, yes or no? If it did, it would go into the language or the system design ideas. If it didn't, we'd get rid of it. That the language and the system evolved to solve the problem, that's the point. We weren't out to make a language with a specific set of properties, we were out to make a language and a system to solve this problem. And these two went hand in hand. So for example, the reason we added links was we could use them in a specific way to solve the problem, in a very practical way for it. That's why they're added. They're quite cool, but they weren't added for the coolness, they're added for the usability. So where we ended up was a number of first principles. So we needed lightweight concurrency. These applications are, by their nature, extremely concurrent. There's just no way around that. So you need to be able to handle a lot of lightweight concurrency. A large number of processes, you need process creation, context switching, communication to be very cheap. Having tens of thousands or even hundreds of thousands of processes was something worth thinking about the whole time, and you have to be able to design the system around that. Asynchronous communication, that was part of the application, and we also found a very nice build tool. We need process isolation. That goes together with the error handling. When things go wrong, when processes die, you don't want them to affect other processes. That's just it. I mean, if one process crashes and ruins the memory for another process, then you're in serious trouble. So we didn't do that. If we want error handling, we want primitives for handling errors in the system. They just have to be there, and it's just as fundamental as the concurrency. Could we not build a fault-tolerant system, it wouldn't be interesting. And we need primitives for continuous evaluation of the, continuous evolution of the system. A few other things, we wanted a high-level language compared to the languages in those days. Our language actually was quite a high-level language. We wanted the language to be simple. Very basic and very simple. And simple in the sense that there's just a small number of basic principles. It's easy to add a new idea, a new principle, new principle, new principle, new principle, every time you dream up something, right? But in the end, you get a right mess. So you want to keep the basics very simple. And if you get these right, you'll still get a very simple, you'll get a very powerful language, because you can build things on top of it, but the basics are simple. I think we actually managed to do that. The language should be simple to understand and program as well. That's why one reason our language is just so basic, because it's easier to see things. And we provide tools for building the systems, not solutions. We don't provide a complex functionality in the language, we provide tools for building that complex functionality. The two main reasons for this is, if you start providing solutions, you'll end up having to provide a lot of solutions. If you provide the right tools, you can do it with a very few small number of tools. And we got it wrong. We attempted sometime to provide solutions, but they were generally wrong. We had misunderstood the problem from the beginning anyway. So we might have had a fantastic solution. We'd ask someone, say, no, they can't use it anyway. So we just got rid of it. So keep it very simple, keep the basics simple. And if you look at it, say the concurrency model, see a bit more in a moment, there are about four basic principles behind it, the same with the error handling, and with those you can build anything you want to on top of it. You want a complex form of communication, you can build it on top of the simple ones. Nothing we have to put in. It also makes it very versatile. The sequential language, it's a simple functional language. Okay, there's nothing. If you look at the sequential language itself, it's nothing exceptional in any way. How does it work? Okay, it's a simple functional language. It has a different syntax, but then again, most functional languages have a different syntax. So if you compare the syntax of any functional language, it'll be different from what you're used to. Even if you go to something like F#, which comes from a major supplier and part of the whole .NET world, it looks very different from C#. Just a fact of life. It was safe. Well, that's nothing strange. It's reasonably high level. It still is, actually. It's dynamically typed. We can have a long discussion on whether it should be statically typed and dynamically typed. I think someone once said it's because we couldn't write a type system. That's wrong. We didn't know how to write compilers or virtual machines either, but we taught ourselves that, so we could have taught ourselves the type system we wanted to. I'll take the discussion later. There are a number of reasons why it is like this. It basically had to be like this. And the same thing with that there are no user-defined data types. The sequential language, yes, it's immutable data. That's fine, typical standard functional. Very nice, actually, do it that way. Once you get used to it, you sort of wonder how you could have a language that doesn't have immutable data. Immutable variables. Yes, there's a big discussion about whether you should have those or not. We went for that. Extensive use of pattern matching. If you haven't seen pattern matching before, you don't understand what you've missed. It makes for very clear, very concise code, both when building things or when matching against things. There are no looping constructs, so you just have recursion. That can affect people sometimes. If you come from a more traditional language, you've been told don't use recursion because it's bad. And we're saying, use recursion, because that's all you got. So, <yeah. laughs> and if you get it right, it's fantastic. It's great. It's very powerful. I just want to say one thing about the pattern matching. The standard pattern matching against various data types like tuples and lists is very practical and useful, but nothing exceptional. We extended that even to that to binary data. So there's a concept of a binary, which is just a block of bytes. Very uninteresting data type as such. The interesting bit is the interface of that data type. So this pattern describes an IPv4 packet in one go. So it's four bits of version, 4 bits of header length, 8-bit service type, a 16-bit total length, 16-bit ID, you've got flags, fragment offsets, types, time to lives, everything like this. That one pattern describes the whole structure of an IPv4 packet. Now I can use that structure both as a pattern, so if I get a packet and I just pull it apart in one go, or I can use it as a pattern to build a packet in the same way. Now if you compare that, how much code that is, to if you do it yourself in C or in Java, there's quite a significant difference. The whole thing with pattern matching, I don't know if everyone's used it or not, the whole thing with pattern matching is you write down what you want the thing to look like, not how to pull it apart. The system will build code to pull that apart for me. I don't have to do that. I want to write down what it looks like. Right? The system will do it both when I'm building. This is just, I think we took pattern matching a step further than most other languages had, at least in those days. Pattern matching is not uncommon these days, but I don't think they do it on binary data. So yeah, another thing we found out, is we don't do defensive programming. Okay. If you want to sit right and handle error cases everywhere, the code is very quickly becomes very complex, very hard to understand what's going on, and you're most likely to miss the cases anyway. I've been there, done that, right? So, yeah. We want to program for the correct case. We want to write the code as if everything just works, and When something goes wrong, get an exception generated by the system or perhaps by ourselves. Preferably if we can let the system do it for us, so we don't even have to worry about that. Yeah, that's, again, a basic philosophy for it. So how can you build a system and a language that allows you to do this? Okay, that's a goal. That was a goal. So getting on to the concurrency, Mike Williams, okay, we were three of us who did most of the basic Erlang development. It was Joe Armstrong, it was Mike Williams, and it was myself. I think Joe was first. He says, I'm number two. I can't honestly remember, but we were three at the beginning. And we'd be arguing about what you shouldn't, or what the language should not look like. But Mike said, he'd written down that if you want to make a concurrent language, that's central the central features you need times to create processes, you need times to perform a context switch between processes, and time for communication. These are the three things you really have to solve if you want a language based on concurrency. Okay. And that's what we tried to do. So what about processes? It's lightweight processes. So we're not talking operating system processes here. Most operating systems, they're way too heavy for our use. We do them ourselves. So millions of processes is definitely possible. A colleague of mine, he just started creating processes. He ran out of 20 million processes. It just ran out of memory in the system. The current Erlang system can support at most, I think, 130 million processes, if you tell it to. We run everything in processes. That's just the way it is. And processes are equal. There are no special processes. Erlang's a very egalitarian system. Everything's created equal, right? So all processes are equal. We use processes for everything. For concurrency, managing state, that's just how you do it. Processes are isolated, so one dies, doesn't affect any other ones. And there is actually no global data in the system. There is globally accessible data, but there is no global data in the traditional sense. Again, we only provide the basic primitives. You can start a process, you can send messages to a process, you can receive messages from a process, and that's about it. Literally, that's it. You can give a process a name, a local name. So it's very cheap as asynchronous message passing. We use a selective receive. So you send a message to a process, then the process itself can say, which messages am I interested at the moment, using pattern matching. That is very nice when you start thinking about it. It means that I can only, every time I want a message, I can only worry about the message I'm actually interested in, and I can ignore all other messages. Irrespective of what I'm doing, I can just look at the message I want now, ignore everything else, which stops the combinatorial explosion. I mean, these type of systems are usually very non-deterministic, they're asynchronous, and anything can arrive at me, and I have to be able to handle it sometime. But I don't have to handle it everywhere. And if you start thinking about having to handle everything everywhere in a system, you completely lose control very quickly. And you can use more complex, you can build more complex functionality using this very simple selective receives and sends, asynchronous message sending. I want concurrent messages, I send a request, I sit and wait for the reply to send back. I want to handle timeouts, I can do that while I'm sitting waiting for a message. I want to handle errors, then I can do that explicitly myself. So I can explicitly program the type of interface, interaction I want with other processes for that specific case. Yes, you could put in a functionality called solutions to do that, but you either get a lot of them or we get very complex ones with an enormous number of options for controlling all these things. We went the other way and say, no, you code it exactly as you want it. Which means you can have different types of functionalities in different parts of the system depending on what you need. There's a concept called ports. That's just for talking with the outside world. From the Erlang point of view, it looks like a process. You send a message to the port, that message arrives at the other end of the port, which is somewhere outside the system. If they wanted to send something back, they'll send it back and you'll see it as a message. So it's just basic message passing with the outside world, whether it's hardware or whatever it might be. So from our point of view, when we were talking with telecoms hardware, you wanted to set the hardware to something, you'd send it a message. When something happened in the hardware, like someone lifted the receiver or something happened, you would get a message from the system saying, this had happened. It makes a very simple, consistent type of interface. Yeah. A bit of trivial code. How many people know or have seen Erlang at all? Am I talking? Most are, okay. So this is, it's trivial, it's a toy code, but it's actually toy code that worked, okay? So we could run it, we could run this on our system, on our own little box here. So this is just example code of the type, this is an example of the type of code we would be programming, building, using Erlang to build a system with. So here we've got, we're in the middle of a telephone call, I've lifted my receiver, I've dialed another number, and ringing my phone is ringing on the other side. So I'm on the A side, and we've got the ringing on the B side. So what happens, if I put down the receiver, I go on hook, I get an on hook message, I tell the B side cleared, that's what I'm doing there, I'm sending it to it, I'm telling the operating, the telecoms system to stop the tone, and I go to idle state. What happens on the B side? That's not my problem. I've told it, I've cleared now, so don't go. On the B side, when I get it cleared, I tell the system to stop the ring in the phone, and I go to idle state as well. I don't have to worry about the A side. If the B side goes off hook, that means they lift the receiver and they're answering. I stop the ringing, and I tell the A side that they've answered, and I go to speech state. The A side gets an answer. It stops its tone, and it tells the switch to connect between us and between me and them. Then we go to speech state. If someone tries to talk to me, someone tries to connect to me, they'll send me a C's, I'll reply and say reject it because I'm busy. And I stay in the same state and the same thing there. If I don't get anything else, I just ignore it here. I don't care about anything else. I'll just consume it, but I'll just throw it away. This actually worked. This simple code worked. Also quite a common way of doing this, you have separate processes for A and B side. And we not only had the hardware, we actually had a simulator as well we could run it on. So when you start up TeleOS, you could say, are you talking with the hardware or talking to the simulator? And you can press these things and ring and make tones ring and things like this as well too. That still exists. I don't think you can run on anything, but it still exists. The simulator. So that's the type of thing we were talking about. Even in this very simple case of a simple call, A calls B, you'd have at least two processes in the system, an A side process and a B side process. You will have an A, the process for the A telephone and the B telephone as well on top of that. So you'd have at least four processes in this case, which means the number of processes grows very quickly, and which means you have to be able to handle a large number of processes. It's just part of the problem. You cannot solve it otherwise. Error handling, the basic premise is errors will always occur. If you want to make a fault, the way to make a fault-tolerant system is not try to get rid of all the errors, is to make a system that can handle errors. However good you are, you will always get errors in the system, whether it's in the code, it's in the hardware, it's in something someone else has written, or something that comes from the outside world. You get errors, you have to write a system that can handle errors. And from our point of view, the basic premise was the system must never go down. You might lose calls, yes, but the system must not go down. Exactly what your system needs to do, that may vary. You yourself have to work out what is critical. What can I accept going wrong? What can't I accept going wrong? And how should I handle those cases? But the Erlang error handling mechanisms give you the primitives for doing that. So if you have a system, it must be able to detect, contain, handle, and recover from errors. Just accept that they're going to occur. That's a fundamental property. If your system cannot do that, well, if our system could not do that, it wasn't interesting, because that's always going to occur. So it must be aware of errors, but we want to avoid writing error checking code everywhere. That's getting back to don't do defensive programming. Writing error code, checking code is very difficult and very tedious. We want to be able to handle processes crashing. Even if I've got a bunch of processes working together, one of them might crash, I have to be able to handle that in an easy way. And I want to interact well with the process communication mechanisms. So the basic, whoops, do I go two now? Yeah. We want to just, if something goes wrong, just let it crash. Someone else will clean up after us. The system designed in some way, I can quite happily crash my process and someone else will know what to do. So it's process based. We're using links for linking processes together. So if one dies, the rest will die as well. And we have system processes that, where they're just monitoring other processes. And if they detect a process has crashed, they will know what to do to clean up after it. Whether to reset hardware, close things, whatever it might be. The code handling, yeah. Well, the unit of code, all code handling is the module. You compile modules, you load modules, you delete modules, it's just at the module level. It's just a way of working with it. And we had to be able to do code upgrades in a nice way, we have two versions. You can have two versions of the same module in the system at the same time, both being in use. Using that, you can define code upgrade. But to do that, you need to be very well defined what happens. Right? You need to know, if I call a function, what happens exactly when I'm calling a function from the point of view of code? And if I load a module, how is that going to affect my functions and my code handling? If you have these very well defined, you can do the code loading. Many systems, you might be able to do dynamic code handling, but it's not very well defined what happens. What happens if in another system, if I reload a module, and what functions actually inside that code being evaluated? What's going to happen? We know. Distribution, yes, you just need primitives for distribution. Okay, robust systems. How you build a robust system. Okay. There are at least two things you need to be able to do to make a robust system. There are more here, but at least two. You need to guarantee this, that some functionality is always available. If the system is to work, I need to have these things always available for me. And if they crash and go down, the system has to make sure that they come back up again and they're still there. That's one feature I need. Another feature is that when things crash, the system can clean up afterwards. So if I've allocated resource and I crash, those resources will get freed and handed back again so they can be reused, for example. And these two things, at least, you need to be able to do if you want to make a fault-tolerant system. You also need distribution. You need at least two machines if you want to make it really fault-tolerant. So for the availability, we have the concept of supervision trees. You have supervisors, you have workers. Workers do all the work. Supervisors keep track of the workers, and if a worker process dies, the supervisor knows how, if, and when to restart that process to make sure the functionality is available. The basic concept is actually very simple, and it's very easy to use. We need to be able to monitor processes. I need to be, me as a resource handler or resource provider, I need to be able to keep track of all the processes that are using my resource, so when they crash, I can clean up after them. It's as simple as that. We use links in both cases to do that. The OTP, which Chassé was mentioning, it stands the open telecom platform, but there's nothing about telecoms in it. Okay. It's just a set of design patterns for building fault-tolerant systems and code support for using those design patterns. That is just what it is. It's quite complex in doing it. And there's support for building these things as well. That's what it is. So it's a set of design patterns of library support tools, and there's nothing about telecoms in OTP. So if you don't be scared of the fact it says telecoms in the name, there is nothing about telecoms in it. There's an ASN.1 compiler in the system because ASN.1 is often used for protocols. That's about as close as it gets. Right? Another point here, the systems built with Erlang, they tend to be very operating system-like. In the sense that they will provide a lot of services for you, like in an operating system. And it's very seldom there's a central thread of execution in the system. In the sense that the system is trying to do one thing like this. At most, you'll have something which separates into tasks. So for example, if you're doing something like a web server, there is no central execution in the web server. There are lots of little processes doing it, handling separate connections, and all going their own life through this. Very seldom a simple thread of execution in the system. This again gets very much back to an operating system. You will have lots of processes in the operating system doing things. You want to do something new, you start a new process in the operating system, which can then access all the other resources. And when it's done, it goes away. Do something else, another process comes along. You very seldom have this central thread of execution in the system. So we're almost done now. Getting back to the problem domain of this, the thing that makes Erlang still very modern in a sense is that if you start looking at these things, this is not just telecoms. Especially the first one, for example, that's timing. I want to be able to know when things done, how long time they're done. I need to make sure that if something's going to start up in 5 milliseconds, it actually starts up in 5 milliseconds. For example, I need to be able to control latency. The system must never block, because then I lose that thing. So that, for example, that feature means quite a lot in the system. That affects quite a lot of things about how the system is designed. And a bit of bragging here is that people are finally starting to realize that a lot of the basic principles Erlang is built on top of are now becoming very interesting. Okay, it's based on actors. Actors are very, very cool these days. It's based on asynchronous message passing. Asynchronous message passing is very cool these days. Well, it is. It's funny. But you build on reactive.
Before, right?
What?
It was before.
Well, for many it wasn't. For many people, asynchronous communication, what's that? Right. Of course, I send a message and get something. I send a request and get a reply back, do a remote procedure call. It's reactive systems. All these systems are reactive systems. They've always been reactive systems. But just quite lately, these things are coming into it. Now, I'm not saying in any way that we were the first to do this. We weren't. What I'm saying is we managed to pick together the right collection of things to make it interesting, which means it's still interesting today. That's why Erlang is still useful today. Because now that you find that, yes, I want all these type of things in my systems. I want reactive systems, that's how it works. I need to be able to control time. I want low latency. I want to make sure that the system never blocks doing something else when I send my request in. All these features that were part of the Erlang system are interesting. They've always been interesting. A lot of times people have not realized it or done other ways of doing it. So that's why. And also the Erlang concurrency model scales. Having these actors-based systems, it scales. Having each one being separate entities, communicating, sending messages, scales. Much better than most other things. Now I want to say, Erlang is definitely not good for everything. There are like classes of applications you would not write in Erlang. Definitely. Well, you shouldn't. But it's very good at talking with other things. I can use it to interface other things, and I can use it to control other things. So you'll find in many Erlang applications, parts of the application will be written in other languages or other systems, and using Erlang to communicate and control them between things. It's very good at doing that. I wouldn't go as far as saying most applications, but very many applications are built along that way. Nothing strange. I think Robbie will be describing a bit about that later, or one way of doing that later on. How to do that. And yeah, the final slide here. Who's using Erlang? This is a pattern of back to show how good we are. It's actually being used. It's relatively low hype value, but it's being used. And very often, you will find you're actually accessing systems that are using Erlang, although perhaps they don't know about it and you don't know about it. If you're sending data over your mobile phone, you're most likely going through Ericsson products that do that, which are built on top of Erlang. RabbitMQ is written in Erlang. How many systems aren't using RabbitMQ or EbbJabbit for messaging? They don't know they're using Erlang. They don't care they're using Erlang, but they are. React databases. How many React databases are there out there in the world today? And that's growing. Again, it's implemented in Erlang. Most of the users don't care, don't need to know, and don't care that it's there. So there's a lot of systems out there doing that. WhatsApp, of course, as someone tweeted, 19 billion reasons to use iPhone. A relatively recent one is Bet365. It's on online British online betting site, one of the bigger ones in the world. They're using Erlang for part of their system. If you go to the Code Mesh conference last month, there's a presentation from a guy from Bet365 about their experiences of using Erlang. A lot of other things I'm not going to go through. Okay, that's about it. So hopefully a bit of information about why it looks like it does. There is a reason for it. There was a reason. One question. Yeah, you were first.
Okay, so I hear that the limitation of two versions was taken from JAM virtual machine. What was the trade-off on this moment?
Okay. Why only two versions of the code? A couple of reasons. One, it just happened. It just ended up being that. It was enough. It was enough to do what we wanted to do. You could have had more. You could have had code as a data type, which it isn't today. We just never did that. We just didn't then have the need for it.
Okay, but it was the JAM specific problem, or because I heard that this was only because of JAM, not because of later?
Well, JAM was the first. JAM stands for Joe's Abstract Machine. It was the first Erlang virtual machine we implemented. That's where we started experimenting with doing code, and that's where we end up having two versions of code, and that's what we found was enough to do the type of code handling we wanted to do. And there have been suggestions afterwards maybe to extend this, not have three or four or something like this, but a much more general code handling system. But it's never happened. It just hasn't evolved.
Thank you.
Okay. Yeah, if you have more questions, we can talk later.
All right, let's thank Robert again.